If you're looking for freedom, looking for a breakthrough, looking for somebody who knows every pain that you hold and the things that you've gone through. Amen. Amen. Good morning and welcome to Life from Christ International Church. This is our Sunday school hour. I pray you all had a blessed week. I pray that the Lord had encouraged you and strengthened you on this week. For the sake of time and me trying to stay within our allotted time, we're going to go right into our Sunday school lesson. We have an hour. And so this is our Sunday school hour. We're going to try and stay within that limit. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, for our Sunday school. We thank you, Father, for the lesson that we're going to study on this morning. We thank you, Father, for what we will glean. Thank you for the opportunity to read in your word and to study. We invite you, Father. We invite your presence, Father, into our Sunday school hour. We invite you into this time. We honor you for being our God. We thank you, Father, for saving us. We thank you for blessing us, for anointing us, and for keeping us. Father, we ask that you will continue to go before us in all things. We honor you. We bless you. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen. Amen. I'm Dr. Alicia Williams. I'm the lead pastor here at Life in Christ International Church. We are a prayer outreach and short-term missions church. That's our focus. We're just now getting things off the ground. We just started this new church, virtual church, in January, and we're excited about what the Lord is doing. We're excited about what God is providing for us, and we continue to press forward and press on in the things of God. And so welcome to our Sunday school hour. This is our Sunday school lesson. This is what we're going to be reading about this morning in our Sunday school book. The title of the lesson this morning is The Faith in Action Preacher. The Faith in Action Preacher. And as always, our Sunday school lesson always gives us a weekly devotion. And this week, our devotion was coming from Ezekiel 18. Verses 25 through 32. And I believe that that devotion really helped set us, set our focus. And excuse me, I'm going to be rattling some pages here in just a minute. Trying to get to our Sunday school page. But our devotion was talking to us this week about the house of Israel, and it was talking about repenting, and I think that that's in line with what the Faith in Action Preacher, the lesson that we're studying about this morning in our Sunday school hour, is ministering to us this morning. And as I was reading the scripture and as I was reading the actions that were taken, it really hit close to home, and it really hit close to the nature of repentance. It really hit close to the damage that sin can cause in our lives if we don't address it, if we don't yield to God's plan and to God's way. And so I pray that this lesson really ministers to you this morning. This, I believe, is one of those lessons that I would call meat instead of milk, because this lesson causes you to come face to face with who you are in God and what God desires for your life. And being able to make those decisions, the right decisions, to choose God's way and choose God's will. And so we're going to go ahead and get into our lesson. So our background scripture this morning is Ezra chapter 9 and chapter 10. Now, of course, our Sunday school lesson isn't going to be able to provide the scripture for both chapters. So we have some verses from chapter 10 that we're going to be reading in our Sunday school hour this morning. And so if you haven't already, you want to take some time to read Ezra chapter 10 and also Ezra chapter 9. Our lesson names this morning, I love these lesson names. We're going to summarize Ezra's reaction to the people's sin. We're going to explain why intermarriage with foreigners caused Ezra grief. And then we're going to write a confession to God for a specific sin and a corresponding course of repentant action. And so when I said this lesson really hits close to home, this lesson challenges, but at the same time, it enriches and it makes us right. It forces us and strongly encourages us to get it right and be right with God. And so that's our scripture this morning. We're going to go into our activity pages. Normally, with our activity pages, I like to set it up where you get an opportunity to answer. But for the sake of time, we're going to go straight into the activity pages answers. We're going to recap about what our lesson aims were and whether or not we were able to accomplish those. We're going to talk real briefly about next week. I'll share the announcements because next week we have our end of month message. And then we're going to close out in prayer. And we have, we have Thursday evening, our midweek Bible study. And so our key verse this morning for Sunday school is coming from Ezra chapter 10, verse 6. And Ezra 10, 6 reads, "Then Ezra withdrew from before the house of God and went to the room of Jehohanan, son of Eliashib. While he was there, he ate no food and drank no water, because he continued to mourn over the unfaithfulness of the exiles." So that key verse gives us an idea of what we are reading about this morning, what is going on. And so let us get right into what we're going to be reading and studying out of our Sunday school lesson. As we already know, these are some lesson aims. We're going to summarize Ezra's reaction to the people's sin. We're going to explain why intermarriage with foreigners caused Ezra's grief. And we're going to write a confession to God for a specific sin and a corresponding course of repentant action. This last one, a lot of people shy away from this. A lot of people are private people, but this last one allows us to reach for being free in the things of God. And when you confess and you repent, God frees you up. That frees you up. You're no longer yoked or tethered or in bondage. And so we want to honor and glorify God for this opportunity in our Sunday school hour this morning. Okay, so this is, we're going to read the first four verses. This morning we're reading in Ezra, the 10th chapter. We're going to be reading from verses 1 through 12, but the way that the Sunday school lesson is designed, we're going to read the first four verses first, and then we'll read, I believe it's 5 through 9, and then we'll read the last remaining verses. And so with that being said, let us go into God's word. What I like to do during the Sunday school hour, I like to, of course, read the scripture and then allow the scripture to minister to our hearts. And then I'd like to go into our Sunday school book and glean from the insight that our Sunday school lesson provides for us. And so our scripture reading is starting with verse 1. "While Ezra was praying and confessing, weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God, a large crowd of Israelites, men, women, and children gathered around him. They too wept bitterly." Verse 2, "Then Shechaniah, son of Jehiel, one of the descendants of Elam, said to Ezra, 'We have been unfaithful to our God by marrying foreign women from the peoples around us. But in spite of this, there is still hope for Israel. Now let us make a covenant before our God to send away all these women and their children, in accordance with the counsel of my Lord and of those who fear the commands of our God. Let it be done according to the law.'" Verse 4, "Rise up. This matter is in your hands. We will support you. So take courage and do it." And so this morning, in these verses, we see that there is a blatant sin. There is a blatant disobedience against God's command for the children of Israel. The children of Israel have married foreign women. And our Sunday school lesson is going to teach us about this rule. It's going to teach us about this dilemma. It's going to teach us about why Ezra needs to take the actions that he needs to take, why the people need to respond the way that they will respond. And so let us go ahead and get into our Sunday school book. Here, the Sunday school book shares with us, under the leadership of Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian Empire overtook Jerusalem and exiled the people of Israel in 586 BC. Eventually, the Persian king, Cyrus, defeated Babylon. He released Jewish exiles to return home to Jerusalem in 538 BC for the express purpose of rebuilding the temple. Following that first wave of returning exiles in 538 BC was a second set of exiles led by Ezra in 458 BC. He desired to restore the people to a state of faithful adherence to God's law. So understand what this is about. Ezra desired to restore the people to a state of faithful adherence to God's law. And so now we have a better understanding of what's transpiring here. The third and final wave of exiles returned to Jerusalem in 444 BC, led by Nehemiah. And that will be in lesson 7. Ezra was a teacher of the law of Moses, commissioned by God. Ezra was made aware that the people of Israel had committed grave sins, and we'll read about that in chapter 9. The most glaring infraction was that they had intermarried with people groups outside of Israel. I'm going to read that again. The most glaring infraction was that they had intermarried with people groups outside of Israel. So now we understand why there was grief. We understand why the sin. The people have been, as the scripture says in verse 2, the people have been unfaithful to our God by marrying foreign women from the peoples around us. And of course, if we know just a little bit, we understand that the people around them are wicked. We understand that the people around them practice wicked ways, and their culture is against God's chosen people, Israel. So that's clear. That's clear. The Sunday school lesson reminds us this prohibition was not based on any racial or ethnic enmity. Rather, God warned in Deuteronomy 7:4 that foreign faiths will turn your children away from following me. So that's another very important reason why they have to take the actions that they will take. Yet, even as they returned from exile for sin, men of Judah were marrying pagan women. If these men were divorcing Jewish wives as well, the result was abuse of divorce laws and resulting hardship for the former wives. Ezra's reaction to the people's disobedience serves as the subject of today's lesson. That gives us a really good background of what's taken place. That gives us a really good background of insight. So now we're going to read about verses 1 through 4. I'm going to start with verse 1. The Sunday school lesson shares, after the initial shock of the report Ezra received, he immediately took it to heart. Ezra led by example. The sincerity of his distress over Judah's sin is emphasized by the intensifying verbs used to describe his actions. Ezra's physical posture matched his spiritual posture before the Lord. Both body and spirit were marked by brokenness and sorrow. I have to read that again. I thought that was really good. Both body and spirit were marked by brokenness and sorrow. And what that means is when we read about the details in scripture, which tells us that Ezra, verse 1, was praying and confessing. Ezra was weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God. And he did it in front of a large crowd of Israelites. He did it in front of men, women, and children who were gathered around him, who also too wept bitterly. And so when you're faced with a matter like Ezra's faced with, it requires drastic measures. It requires you to take drastic steps. It requires, as our Sunday school lesson shares with us, both body and spirit must be marked by brokenness and sorrow. And that moves a nation, that drives a divine change, that drives a divine shift in the hearts and the lives of men. Not to line up with Ezra, not to line up with what Ezra is doing, but to line up with the divine will and divine purpose of an almighty God. And so this is a great lesson. This is a great gift that the Lord has given us this morning in the Sunday school hour. So the Sunday school book says, the house of God refers to the temple that had been rebuilt after Solomon's temple was destroyed in the Babylonian conquest. And you can read about that in 2 Chronicles chapter 36. Construction was completed in 515 BC, and this second temple stood until the Romans destroyed it in AD 70. So, great information, great detail. The Sunday school lesson says, people of all ages need good leaders. This is as true in the area of repentance as anything else. When charting revivals in the Old Testament, movements towards God often started with one leader feeling a burden. Though the circumstances varied, the initiating factor for revival was someone acting on behalf of the people. The leaders may have had a private revelation or realization, followed by the gathering of an assembly, as here in verse 1. Here, Ezra's own conviction and contrition became an example for others to gather before the Lord and weep over their sins. I really love that. Here, Ezra's own conviction and contrition became an example for others to gather before the Lord and weep over their sins. This is a powerful lesson this morning. This is a powerful insight and guidance that the Lord is providing for us. And so let's continue to read. Let's see what the Sunday school lesson shares with us about verses 2 through 4. All right, so the Sunday school lesson says, in the Old Testament, there are at least 9 men named Shechaniah, 9 named Jael, and 8 named Elon. Sorting them out is difficult, the Sunday school lesson shares. The Shechaniah who speaks here is a descendant of David according to 1 Chronicles chapter 3. His father, Jehiel, was likely also the father of Obadiah, one of the returning exiles. Our Sunday school lesson, we're going to have some rattling pages here in just a second. Our Sunday school lesson shares that Jehiel is included in a grouping of those guilty of intermarriage. So we understand who's who. We understand the background of those that we're reading about. Not in our printed text, it doesn't share this. It is plausible that Shechaniah overcame personal and familiar shame to speak up and not attempt to cover up his family sin. And that's good to know. The Hebrew word translated been unfaithful regularly denotes the violation of a covenant, relationship, or other expected behavior in the Old Testament. Marital unfaithfulness is a frequent analogy regarding Israel's relationship to God, with Israel being the adulteress, and the adulterous wife, and you'll read about that in Isaiah 62, and you can read about that in Jeremiah chapter 3 and Ezekiel chapter 16. The Sunday school lesson reads, the foreign women were those not part of the covenant people. Israel had been repeatedly warned that the peoples around them in Canaan would lead them into apostasy. Whether these particular wives were guilty of such a thing is unknown. However, the sad example of Solomon, the wise king, whose foreign wives turned his heart after other gods, should have stood as a grave warning in the time after the exile. Ezra's contemporary, Nehemiah, reminded the people of Solomon's failure, exhorting them not to suffer the same fate. A repentant heart is what makes hope possible for right relations with God to be restored. I have to reread that because I think that's important. A part of what we're reading about this morning. It's an important part of where our Sunday school lesson is leading us and taking us. And so the Sunday school book says, a repentant heart is what makes hope possible for right relations with God to be restored. The Sunday school lesson says, God's patience with his people is demonstrated time and again throughout the Old Testament. The prophet often invokes past episodes of God's gracious deliverance in order to motivate the people toward obedience. Ezra reminded the remnant in Jerusalem that you, God, have punished us less than our sins deserved. Hope is always grounded in the possibility of God's mercy. After moral failure or personal tragedy, hope exists because, as King David learned firsthand, God is good, and what he does is good. And you can read that in Psalms 119. Hope, grounded in God's goodness, led others to write of God's being gracious, slow to anger, and full of mercy. And you can read that in Psalms 103, Psalms 145, Joel chapter 2, and Jonah chapter 4. In verse 3, the now signals a step forward from the sins of past and present. This suggestion from Shechaniah is drastic and may appear cruel to modern readers. Some might wonder if God really wanted the men to send away their wives and their children. Considering Deuteronomy chapter 21, but in the days following the return from Babylon, the people were very aware of how unfaithfulness had led to their removal from the promised land. Foreign women could very well lead their husbands back into idolatry, as had happened to King Solomon. Thus, the threat the foreign wives posed was too great to ignore. The people had to be intent on being holy in order to please God. And I want to read that again. The people had to be intent on being holy in order to please God. So we read some very good information here in the Sunday school book. We read, I think, the gist of why the people have to do what it is that Shechaniah has suggested to Ezra. Also, our Sunday school lesson shares about the failure of King Solomon, whose heart was turned away to idol gods because of his foreign wives. And so this paints a very good picture. This paints a very good reason as to why the actions that they take are definitely necessary. And then what our Sunday school book just read, it told us that the people had to be intent on being holy in order to please God. So they don't want to be in sin. They don't want the wrath of God. They don't want to be exiled. They want to be returned to their promised land. And they want to please God. They want to be in right relationship with God. So all of these things encourage the actions and the steps that are necessary. And so the Sunday school lesson reads, we should note that God's covenant people were not to mistreat non-Israelites who lived among them, quite the opposite. But treating non-Israelites with kindness isn't in the same category as intermarriage. The extraordinary circumstance that people face called for extraordinary action, and we understand that now. Shechaniah referred to Ezra differentiating him as my Lord. So that's how Shechaniah addressed Ezra. This address, the Sunday school lesson reads, acknowledged Ezra's authority to decide and lead the people based on what he believed was right. Ezra, after all, was both student and teacher of the law of Moses, and we understand how important that is. His conclusions on this matter were well informed. Ezra's conclusion on this matter were well informed. The Sunday school lesson reads, reverence and awe were given to God's words as if God himself were present. God helps those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at God's word. And we can read that in Isaiah 66. In the view is the law that forbade certain marital unions. Notable law breakers in this regarded included Solomon, who married Rahab, a Canaanite, and Boaz, who married Ruth, a Moabite. These two women are honored as ancestors of Jesus himself. And you can read that in Joshua chapter 2. Ruth chapter 4, Matthew chapter 1. But the captivity from which the Jews had returned was a vivid reminder of the dangers of idolatry. Maybe some non-Jewish wives were exceptions to the rule, like Rahab and Ruth, but the law existed because such cases were exceptions, not the rule. And we also note that Rahab and Ruth professed allegiance to God in both in word and in action. And so that's a great distinction of I really appreciate this school lesson expressing that to us. There were two, we know Rahab who married, and we know Ruth who married, but both of them, as our Sunday school lesson reminds us, professed allegiance to God, both in word and in action, and that's a big difference. And so it doesn't oppose, and as the Sunday school lesson reminds us, that is an exception to the rule. And when you read about their stories and you read about what transpired in God's word, you understand that God was in the midst of everything that had transpired. Our Sunday school lesson continues and it says, we can only imagine the overwhelmingly emotional toil of separating from one's wife and children. The difficulty of the demand is what brought forth a strong imperative rise up. This marks the beginning of the shift from conviction to action on the part of the leaders. I love that. I love how that's expressed. This marks the beginning of the shift from conviction to action on the part of the leaders. In any circumstance, in any situation, depending on how hard you're hit by what is going on, that conviction often shifts you to action. It shifts you to be better. It shifts you to do better. It shifts you to grow up, to mature, to overcome, to accomplish, to... So you just can't be convicted and then remain in the same place. That's a spiritual death. That's a spiritual separation that you don't want to experience. And so right now, we fully have, I believe, a better understanding of Ezra's praying at the temple. We have a full understanding of Shechaniah's instructions to Ezra, and we have a full understanding of what needs to transpire now, and we have a full understanding of why the time has come for them to rise up, why this matter is so important. And so that takes us into the next set of verses 5-8, and we're going to go ahead and read that. Again, we're in Ezra chapter 10, We're reading verses 5 through 8. Verse 5 reads, "So Ezra rose up and put the leading priests and Levites and all Israel under oath to do what had been suggested, and they took the oath." Verse 6, "Then Ezra withdrew from before the house of God and went to the room of Johanan, son of Eliashib. While he was there, he ate no food and drank no water, because he continued to mourn over the unfaithfulness of the exiles." And that's our key verse. Verse 7, "A proclamation was then issued throughout Judah and Jerusalem for all the exiles to assemble in Jerusalem." Verse 8, "Anyone who failed to appear within 3 days would forfeit all his property, in accordance with the decision of the officials and elders, and would himself be expelled from the assembly of the exiles." And so we understand that there is a command to take some very strict and very harsh actions to get things right with the Lord. And so they have called an assembly, and whoever fails to appear at the assembly within 3 days will forfeit their place in God, basically. They will forfeit their place in, they'll forfeit their property and their place among the assembly. And so there is an urgent response. There is a urgent actions that need to be taken within a 3 day span. So let's go ahead. Let's read in our Sunday school lesson. Let's see what our Sunday school lesson shares with us this morning. Ezra made sure that the leading priests and Levites and all Israel were on the same page. Opposition to the task ahead had to be absolutely minimal. So the leaders and lay persons made a covenant with God to send away all these women and their children. During this emotional day, Ezra withdrew to be alone in the dwelling of Jehohanan. That man and his father, Eliashib, were Levites. We recall that all priests were Levites, but not all Levites were priests. While the people were grieved and motivated to action, Ezra was overcome with his own grief regarding the unfaithfulness of the exiles. His fast from food and water seems to have been spontaneous, a result of the pain in his spirit. When we think of mourning, it is usually in relation to death, the loss of a loved one or someone special. Ezra carried a sense of loss as he reflected on the years his people wasted as they chased false gods and denied the Lord. It is likely that Ezra gave special charge to the leading priests and Levites to spread news of the need to assemble in Jerusalem. Besides their leadership function, priests and Levites lived among all the tribes. 3 days was a quick turnaround for a message to be proclaimed and journeys to be undertaken through all Judah and back to Jerusalem. But the speed with which repentance and action would happen throughout would indicate the importance the people put on rectifying their wrongs. The severe consequences for not coming to Jerusalem also reveals the seriousness of the people's resolution. Forfeiting one's land and possessions and being cut off from the assembly would be the same treatment the foreign wives experienced. Those who penalized would have to find their homes elsewhere, away from God's people. And so we see that this account of scripture is sharing with us the sin was identified. There was confession and repentance, and then there was action taken. And there was a window of time allotted for those actions to be acted upon, for those actions to be completed. They had 3 days. And We also see Ezra's response and the steps that he took to ensure that the people were well informed, that the people, that the leaders were up front, making sure that these actions were taken care of and these actions were completed. So that takes us to the next set of verses, our last final verses this morning in our Sunday school reading, verses 9 through 12. And Ezra chapter 10, verses 9 through 12 reads, "Within the 3 days, all the men of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. And on the 20th day of the 9th month, all the people were sitting in their square before the house of God, greatly distressed by the occasion and because of the rain. Verse 10, when Ezra the priest stood up and said to them, 'You have been unfaithful, you have married foreign women, adding to Israel's guilt.' Verse 11, now honor the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do his will. Separate yourselves from the peoples around you and from your foreign wives." Verse 12, the whole assembly responded with a loud voice, "You are right. We must do as you say." And in reading this, the Lord reveals that repentance and contriteness and contrition leads people to the right way. It leads people to, no matter how difficult, to make the right choices, to honor and to reverence God. And we see here that our Sunday school lesson ends with all that was required, with all that has transpired, with all that has happened, with "you are right, we must do as you say." And so they're obeying the will of God. Let's continue in reading in our Sunday school lesson this morning. A Sunday school lesson shares with us, 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel had been removed to Assyrian exile more than 180 years previous. So only the 2 tribes of Judah and Benjamin, having returned from Babylon exile, remained to answer the call to come to Jerusalem. The 12th day of the 9th month corresponds to early December. Rain is normal at that point in the year. So in addition to the spiritual distress, there was also physical shivering in the cold, heavy rain. How often the spiritual and the physical overlap? Distress to one's body, whether in form of illness, injury, or mere discomfort, often goes hand in hand with spiritual distress. Sometimes one results in the other, and other times they seem to have independent causes. But the presence of both multiplies the misery. In such conditions, all the people sat outside and waited. The Sunday school lesson reads, sometimes Ezra is referred to as the priest. Sometimes he's referred to as the teacher of the law. And sometimes by both of those terms together. His statement, adding to Israel's guilt, implies that the people hadn't learned the lesson of the exile. Instead of working to decrease sin, they were working for the opposite. So Ezra restated the charge. The Sunday school lesson continues on. Their first response to conviction was to honor the Lord by admitting wrongdoing, a necessary step toward reconciliation with God. The next step is to follow through and do his will. This is what he commanded in the first place, what he desired all along. To be required to separate from their foreign wives was not necessarily a judgment or any specific conduct on the wives' part, since no such conduct is listed. Instead, those wives were assumed to retain the priorities and religious practices of their people of the land among whom they had grown up. Only by severing their influence could the men of Judah and Benjamin be certain that the wives wouldn't tempt them to idolatry. I'm going to have to read that again. Only by severing their influence? Could the men of Judah and Benjamin be certain that the wives wouldn't tempt them to adultery? This is so important. This is very good. And plus, this gives instruction on how to deal with sin, how to deal with what caused you to be separated from God. A Sunday school lesson reads, concluding this part of the text is the loud voice of a unified people who experience conviction of sin. Ezra's leadership helped foster the commitment. Any spiritual leader worth following will always direct people to God and His glory only. Amazing lesson. And so our Sunday school lesson concludes with one of the great gifts for Christian instruction in the Old Testament is seeing episode after episode of Israel's rebellion against God and God's subsequent restoration of His covenant people. In today's text, we have been party to yet another instance of this. The people of God were again in danger of sliding back into adultery because of their disobedience to God's law. This is a reminder that God's law are put in place for our good and His glory. Like the ancient Jews, we too are tempted by the culture that surrounds us, including the temptation to marry unbelievers. God's mercy provided hope for Israel to be restored to a right relationship with Him, but that required someone who would take the lead. Not everyone is gifted in the same way in this regard, and different leaders may respond differently to the same problem. It's rather humorous to contrast Ezra's leadership style, as it's pointed out in Ezra chapter 9, with Nehemiah. But it all begins with having a burden of the heart and soul. But it all begins, I have to reread that, with having a burden of the heart and soul. God's forgiving grace is available to us because of the person and work of Jesus Christ. The church is His bride. May we be faithful to our bridegroom. I love how our Sunday school lesson led us to understand sin and led us to understand conviction and led us to understand repentance. And it led us to understand the action oftentimes that is required. Sometimes we're required to separate ourselves in order that we are restored unto God, restored unto what the Lord has commanded for us. And it requires us to respond with a loud voice, declaring that God is right, declaring that we will do what God said. And so I pray that this lesson blessed you this morning. I pray that it ministered to the sin that you have in your life. And we know the Word of God tells us anyone who says that they are without sin is a liar and that the truth is not in them. And so the Word of God tells us that all have sinned, all have fallen short of the glory of God. And so we need this instruction. We need this right way. We need this right guidance so that we can continue to rip off that garbage off of our lives and continue in the things of God and what God has purposed. As always, I took the liberty to collect some what we call eye candy this morning. I captured some photos for us. Here in left, we'll see the prophet Ezra ministering as the priest and also as the teacher of the law of God to the people. Up at the top, we'll see a depiction of the second temple. This was a depiction of what the second temple looked like in Jerusalem at the time. And then in the bottom right, we see the repentance. We see the contrition. We see the children, the wives, they're repenting. Just as we read about in our scripture reading. And so I pray that this blessed you. I pray that this gave you better insight of what we were reading about, the prophet Ezra, the second temple, and the repentance and the contriteness that transpired. That takes us into our activity page. As I mentioned, for the sake of time, we're going to go straight into our answers. And I pray that you take some time this week and that you fill in your own answers. Of course, Our answers, my answers are going to be different from your answers, but I pray that these answers still bless you and encourage you. So our activity page, lesson six, the faith in action preacher, what would you say? So our instruction says Ezra's bold action requires us to think carefully about why we did what we did. How would you answer someone who said the following? And I love how this is laid out for us, because it requires us to come face to face with making the right choices and making the right decisions, and also saying the right things, and also reminding us that we have an action to take. We just can't read what we're reading. We just can't study what we're studying and not fully commit to taking the action necessary. And so number one says, the remedy for this sin was too harsh. So what this is sharing this morning is that in our scripture reading, we understand that the people of Israel were brought before the house of God to eradicate their sin, and the actions that were required were too harsh. That's what number one is saying. The remedy for this sin was too harsh. And so when you understand that, you have to strip away what separates you from God. You have to strip away what takes you outside of God's will. You have to strip away which causes you to disobey God's command. You have to strip away what puts you in danger of continuing to live in sin. And so when you understand that your soul is at risk, when you understand that your life is at risk, when you understand that your relationship with God is at risk, then there are no harsh actions. There is no harsh remedy. God is the ultimate deal. And so my response to that is the remedy requires you to make a choice. Either you choose God or sin, but you must choose. And my response is, I pray you choose God over sin every time. I pray you choose God over sin every time. And we can't wallow in that place where we're poking around with sin. We don't have the liberty to do that. So again, I pray you choose God over sin every time. Question number two, Ezra acted beyond his level of authority. And so in that scripture reading, we understand that Shechaniah brought the circumstance before Ezra. Ezra, who had already had been praying and weeping in grief because of the sin. And Ezra, who was, as the scripture revealed to us, as our Sunday school lesson reveals to us, was a teacher of the law. And also a student of the law. And he was also called of God in this season to lead the people. So when this says Ezra acted beyond his level of authority, my response to that, according to the scripture reading, according to the actions he took, according to the position he held, that is incorrect. And so my response there is correction. Ezra acted upon the authority given to him by God. And the result that transpired, the response of the people, they fully understood. And therefore, there was a great response in what transpired. There was a great response in what took place. There was a great response in what happened. They were reconciled in the right way unto God because of the actions that were taken. Number three, the people were coerced into observing the will of a dictator. When you understand the Word of God and you fully embrace and accept the Word of God, not in ignorance, but in obedience, you understand that this is to rectify our souls with our Creator. This is to rectify our souls with God. And so Ezra wasn't creating something new for the people to do. This is the actions that were required, the actions that were necessary was to help restore the people to their rightful place and rightful position with God. Help them to get back to where they were supposed to be in the first place. So it wasn't like he was creating something new. And so he was just following the design of God's word and following God's divine will and purpose. And so my response to that would be that statement is an error and it needs to be corrected. So the correction, the people were ready and willing to give up sin because of the exile that they suffered. They knew that there would be consequences for their sin. They understood that. They knew that there would be consequences for living out sin and for living outside of the will of God. And so they were ready. What had transpired, the opportunity that was presented to them, they were ready to embrace the things of God. They were ready to embrace God in full. They were ready to remove themselves and separate themselves from the sin. And so the last one says, compare and contrast your answers with another class member. That's the last and final thing. And in stating that, I know your answers and your response will be different, but I pray that as we continue in our Sunday school lesson, as you take time to create your own answers to this activity page, that the Lord will minister to you, and that at the end of the day, after all is said and done, we're not perfect people. We don't always get it right, but we can come before God, and God can provide instruction just as he did here. God can provide guidance just as he did here, so that we are fully restored in the right way, in the right things with God Almighty. And so that takes us to part two of our activity page. I'm a wordy person, so I had a lot to say, but I really loved the activity here. I really loved having to respond or come face to face with the reality of how we really feel, how our carnal self respond when we're confronted by our sins. And so our instruction here, and I love the title of this, is a stinking thinking. And we know we get there sometime. The thing is not to stay there too long. Amen. And so it says, each of the following statements reflects a common attitude among some toward the problem of sin. How do the examples from today's passage refute the thinking behind each one? Jot your responses in the space provided. So number one says, what I did may be wrong, but I'm certain I'm not the first person to have done it. Cut me some slack. And so this stinking thinking, this lower nature of thinking, this lower way of living when God has called us and encouraged us in his word and by his spirit to come up to a greater level in him. My response is, God has given us grace and conviction. These two gifts help us to get things right with God. My encouragement is, don't ignore conviction and don't abuse grace. Don't ignore conviction and don't abuse grace. So that takes us to number two, and I pray that ministers to you. It may take some time to get there, but continue to press forward in God and continue to press forward in the things of God. Number two, telling the truth about my sin would cause too much hardship and pain for others. I love. I lie to protect them. And so when I read that, that is humanity. That is carnality. That is people who were instructed the wrong way. And so the correction and the right way comes from God. So my response is, a lie begets a lie. And we know this. If you tell one lie, then you're going to have to keep continuing to lie. And who wants to live in that bondage? Who wants to live under that curse? No one wants to live there. And so it tethers you to more sin. It tethers you to more hardship and more pain. And so my encouragement this morning is to trust God for healing. Trust God for deliverance. Trust God to restore you to wholeness. Trust God to forgive you and for you to live and walk in forgiveness and to live and to walk free from all of that. We want to be free. You want to be free. And when you confess and when you repent and when you separate yourself from lies and separate yourself from sin and separate yourself from telling lies, it frees you up and it brings you, allows you the opportunity to grow closer into God and to heal and to restore and all of those things that come along with the things of God. So number three, habits are habits and sometimes they're impossible to break. Give me time while I work on this. And so my encouragement there is amen. Trust God to break the habits and trust God to move you to a greater place in Him. Understanding that we have to position ourselves, work to position ourselves so that God can break those habits and so that God can move us into a greater place with Him. All right, so number four, I've prayed about this and I know God understands. So my response to this, God knows our weakness. God knows our iniquities. He knows our transgressions. He knows our sins. And He doesn't want us to stay in the muck and miry. He doesn't want us to live a life lesser than or lower than He's intended for us. And so my response to that is to turn it over to God completely. Don't try to meddle with it and fix it yourself and do it in your own strength, because it's not in your own strength, but it's God will deliver. It's God who will deliver. And so when the Lord provides an opportunity, jump. When the Lord removes it from you, jump. And so you gotta not make excuses, but you gotta make sure that you turn it completely over to God. Mind, soul, and spirit in every area, in every way. And so that takes us into number five, sin, sin, sin. All you Christians do is fret about sin. Why can't you just live and let live? And so my response to that is the Word of God encourages us to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Romans 12, verse 2. The Word of God encourages us to take off the old man. Ephesians 4, 22. And then the last and final thing, and even with us being in resurrection season, where we celebrated Christ's resurrection on Sunday, my response to this, and then I pray that this hit home, I pray that This really touches you. Jesus suffered the crucifixion to give us an opportunity to be right in and to be right with God. And so let's not dishonor the work of the cross. Let's not dishonor God's divine will and divine purpose for us to be in right standing with Him and in right standing with God. And so don't let sin steal your victory. Don't let sin steal your joy, basically. All right. And so the next one is, what I do in the privacy of my home is my business and mine alone. You take care of your own relationship with God and let me worry about myself. And my response to that is that we encourage one another in the confession of our faith, not just for ourselves alone, but for the lives we may negatively affect. Accountability helps us to get it right. And so that's part two of our activity. I love this activity. I pray that this goes with you throughout the week. The title of this activity, part two, was Stinking Thinking. Now, the final thing that we're required to do is to put a star beside any sentence you may have spoken in the past of any sentence that reflects your thinking today. How does today's study help you change your thinking? And so in that, when I looked at the list, one of my most common go-tos would be number one. So I put a star for me personally. Of course, your answer is going to be different near number one. What I did may be wrong, but I'm certainly not the first person to have done it. Cut me some slack. And so earlier we talked about ignoring conviction, when we talked about the abuse of grace. You want to make sure that you wash all of that stuff off. You want to make sure that you're constantly chipping away and constantly separating yourself from sin and not making excuses and not living in a place of excuse, but rising up higher to where God has called you to be, rising up higher to the things of God and dying to flesh daily, as our scripture tells us. And so that concludes our Sunday school lesson this morning. We were able to summarize Ezra's reaction to the people's sin. We were able to explain why intermarriage with foreigners caused Ezra grief. And our Sunday school activity helped us to write a confession to God for specific sin and the corresponding course of repentant action. I pray that this bless you. Pray that the requirement, the face-to-face responsibility to deal with sin and not just hang out there, that you take the actions necessary, even the most difficult ones, to be right and to get it right with God. Next week, we're talking about the restoring builder. This is going to be really exciting. Our devotional reading this week is Daniel chapter 9, verses 4 through 6. Daniel chapter 9, verses 15 through 19. A background scripture for our Sunday school lesson next week is coming from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 20, and chapter 13, verses 1 through 22. Our key verse next week is Nehemiah 2:17. It says, "Then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I'm looking forward to that lesson. I know it's going to be insightful and enriching. Here's our announcements for the week. We are midweek Bible study every Thursday evening at 7:30 p.m. Next Sunday, we will have our end of month message. The Lord is ministering about this season next month. So I pray that you participate. I pray that you be a part of that. And then finally, our minister's training is continuing on. We're moving into session 4 of our 8 sessions. And so I pray that you all have a blessed week. I pray that the Lord continue to minister this lesson that we studied this morning in your soul. Not only that we read about it, not only that we learned about it, but that the Lord enable us, empower us, and endow us to become it and to walk in it. And with that being said, we're going to go ahead and close out with a word of prayer. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you now, dear God. We thank you for our Sunday school hour. We thank you, Father, for the lesson in which we studied this morning, Lord God. Let it not be far from us, O God, but enable us, empower us, enrich us to embrace it, to understand it, to be it, and to become it. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for providing for us. And Father, as we leave this place, but never ever from your presence, you go with us, go before us. Dispatch angels to encamp about us and keep us on every hand and on every side. We love you, O dear God, for who you are. We thank you for being our God. We thank you for calling us and choosing us to be your people. We honor you now, God, and we ask that you will continue to have your way. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen. Thank you all. God bless, and we'll see you on Thursday evening and Sundays at a midweek Bible study. Amen.